A very good evening to all our viewers and welcome to this Sunday's edition of Primetime News, coming to you live from our News First studios in Colombo. I'm Arundhati Mudanayake. Let's start off with a look at the stories making headlines this evening.
Priyanka Kumara's remains to be flown to Sri Lanka from Pakistan tomorrow. No power cuts today. Continuous power supply from Wednesday. Sapuga Skanda oil refinery to resume operations on Tuesday. Chinese fertilizer company seeks compensation with interest at a Singaporean arbitration center. Ministry secretary ignored instruction before signing the agreement, a revelation by the minister. Agriculture minister questions local agents' conduct when importing liquid nano nitrogen fertilizer.
මේ ආණ්ඩුවේ නැති ඇමතිවරු එවැගේම මේ බලධාරීන් ඔලමොට්ටල තීරණ අරගෙන ගොවියා අද පීඩාවට පත් කරලා තියෙනවා.
Kessel Watte Fawaz stabbed to death.
Now the story is in detail. Remains of the late Priyanka Kumara, who was lynched and murdered in Sialkot, Pakistan, will be brought to the country on a Sri Lankan Airlines carrier at the expense of the state. The Ministry of Foreign Affairs, issuing a release, said that the Sri Lankan High Commissioner's office in Pakistan has requested that an investigative report from the Pakistan Foreign Affairs Ministry on the murder.
Dawn.com, a Pakistan news website, quoting the Punjab Inspector General of Police, reported that the string of incidents that resulted in the brutal murder of the late Priyanka Kumara Diyawadana started at 10:02 on last Friday morning. According to the reports of Dawn.com, Pakistan police have arrived at the scene at about 11:45 in the morning. However, when closely monitoring the footage of the incident circulating on social media, a police officer can be seen walking where the body was burnt. The Punjab Inspector General of Police had said that strict action will be taken if there are any police officers who have neglected their duties at the time of the incident. The post-mortem report of Priyanka Kumara was released today and it shows that his entire body has been subjected to severe burns. Dawn.com reported that severe damages have been caused to Priyanka's internal organs and the severed limbs of his body have been reattached so that the body can be handed over to the Lahore police. More than 230 suspects have been arrested for the killing of Priyanka Kumara, including 13 major suspects. According to Indian media reports, the two main suspects of the murder have been taken to an undisclosed location. The Punjab IGP also said that fundamental investigation reports have been prepared for 900 more employees at the Rajko factory in Sialkot. Footage and data obtained from 160 CCTV cameras have been used in the investigations as well. According to the media spokesperson of the Pakistan government, the Rajko factory in Sialkot has been temporarily shut down as of now. In a tweet, the Pakistani Prime Minister said that he salutes the bravery of Malik Adnan, who tried his utmost to shelter and save Priyanka Diyawadana from the vigilante mob in Sialkot by endangering his own life by physically trying to shield the victim. Pakistani Prime Minister also said that Adnan will be awarded with the second highest civil award for bravery in Pakistan as well. Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan had certified the Sri Lankan President Gotabaya Rajapaksa that law will be strictly enforced on those who are responsible for the gruesome murder of the late Priyanka Kumara in Sialkot. The late Priyanka Kumara was a resident of Kandali at the Palwa in Ganemulla and was a 48-year-old father of two at the time of his untimely demise. Public representatives and civil activists visited Priyanka's house to convey their condolences to his family members.
Make a strike. There has been a strike at the factory. He had been inside the factory at the time of the strike. People who were engaged in the strike had carried out this gruesome attack.
Sri Lankan High Commissioner to Pakistan, retired Rear Admiral Mohan Vijayvikrama, said that steps are underway to obtain compensation for the family members of the late Priyanka Kumara, who was lynched and murdered in Sialkot, Pakistan. Adding further, retired Rear Admiral Mohan Vijay Vikrama said that the Pakistan government has been informed to take the necessary action to ensure the safety of Sri Lankan migrants currently employed in Pakistan. It is reported that more than 400 Sri Lankan migrants are employed in Pakistan. A group of relatives of the late Priyanth Kumara staged a silent protest in Kandy today, demanding justice for his killing.
We seek justice for this brutal murder. I wish that no Sri Lankan abroad should go through something as cruel as this.
Another silent protest was staged opposite the Dalwa Sambuddha Pirivana in Kalpitiya, demanding justice for the brutal killing of Priyanth Kumara in Sialkot, Pakistan.
The Consumer Affairs Authority says it has allowed gas supplies to resume under certain conditions. This would be after the Ceylon Petroleum Corporation tests samples of stocks imported by both gas companies.
The Consumer Affairs Authority has allowed gas cylinders to be supplied to the market under certain conditions. This includes not releasing previously imported gas cylinders, filling cylinders with the chemical odorant mercaptan, inspecting every 1 in 100 cylinders and sending the serial number to the Consumer Affairs Authority. Gas cylinders will be released to the market under the supervision of a committee appointed to ensure that these conditions are met. Upon inquiries made by News First, the committee appointed by the president said it will provide the required expertise to address the matter. The committee said it will inform the media about its findings next week, although it has 2 weeks to submit the report. Our attempts to contact the chairman of Litrogas Lanka Limited on the changes in gas cylinders supplied to the market today proved futile. Tilak De Silva, the deputy chairman of Lavs Gas, said the gas cylinders imported by the company were tested and that its standards were confirmed. Gas explosions occurred in several parts of the country today as well. A gas leak had occurred after a regulator had removed from a gas cylinder that was brought to a hotel near the Baddegama bus halt in Gaul. The hotel owner had then moved the cylinder outside the store.
ගාලා විනාඩි 5ක් වගේ තමයි ගියේ. ඒක වාටම රෙගුලේටර් එක්කම කඩාගෙන උඩ ගියා. ගෑස් එක උස්සගෙන ගියා කඩේ ඇතුළේ සෙනඟත් ගොඩක් හිටියා. පාර මැදින් තිය වාහන ටික නතර කරා දෙපැත්තෙන් එන ගෑස් එක ඉවර වෙනකම්.
And eatery in Kurundankulam in Anuradhapura was damaged after a fire broke out because of a gas explosion. A gas cooker had exploded at a house in Bodagoduvatta in Gona Pinwala yesterday. A gas cooker had exploded at a house in Irattakulam in Madampe about 30 minutes after it was turned off. Two gas explosions had occurred in Hinguragoda and Kalagahala yesterday and today. The occupants of a house in Hatton had carefully moved a cylinder outdoors after they sensed a gas leak upon returning to their home at around 7 last night. A gas stove had exploded at a house in Irakkamar in Ampara last night. A regulator had caught fire on a gas cylinder in Sarankar in Trincomalee. A gas cooker had caught fire in Shantipuram in Manna.
The Ceylon Electricity Board says that there will be no power cuts today. Its general manager R.M. Ranathunga said that the decision was taken as the electricity demand had dropped today.
The generators of the Norochale Lakvijaya power plant had failed as the country experienced a blackout this week. A decision was then made to cut off electricity supply to some areas for an hour between 6 p.m. and 9:30 p.m. However, the power supply would not be suspended today.
Will there be power cuts tomorrow?
The Ceylon Electricity Board's General Manager R.M. Ranathunga said power cuts may be imposed tomorrow as announced earlier.
From when will power supply be provided without interruptions?
The CEB General Manager noted that power supply can be provided without interruptions from Wednesday. He said he believes that one unit of the Norochale power plant can be connected to the national power grid today.
What was the cost of the recent blackout?
The Ceylon Electricity Board had faced losses of up to 350 million rupees due to the recent blackout. Its general manager R.M. Ranathunga said the losses faced by the CEB had increased by fivefold.
Agriculture Minister Mahinda Nandalutgamge says balance EPF payments to West State workers would be settled even by selling a land in Colombo. He made these remarks when declaring open the Navalapitiya Galabadavatta road that was refurbished recently.
50 varsham kodutilla
EPF, ETF and gratuity payments haven't been made for 50 years. I will settle the payments to all estate workers before April next year. I have discussed with the president to sell a land in Colombo and to settle the EPF and the gratuity payments. You have been working in estates for several years without EPF and ETF payments. If the government can't make these payments, why do we need a government? I asked the president to hand over the GEDB to me. It's in Kandy. I asked for it because I want to work for the Tamil community. Many trade unions are opposing the move to sell national resources to foreign companies. Convening a media briefing, the Petroleum, Ports and Electricity Alliance against the sale of national resources opposed the move to sell 40% of the Keravalapitiya power plant to the American New Fortress Company, the sale of port lands and services which earn dollars to the country and dividing the Ceylon Electricity Board to six parts. We are suspicious as to whether they are trying to sell the Norochole power plant to China or whether they are trying to give money they generate from coal-powered electricity. We don't know whether they have plans to sell Sabugaskanda and Kalanithissa. Therefore, in addition to the gas, sugar and milk powder crises, we will have to face an electricity crisis as well.
Meanwhile, the Sabugaskanda oil refinery that was closed recently as it was facing losses will resume operations on Tuesday. It has been closed for 22 days. On the 15th of November, a decision was made to close down the refinery for 50 days. This was to use foreign currency to buy petrol, diesel, medicine, food and gas instead of spending it to import crude oil.
Sri Lanka has requested for debt relief from lenders, citing its economic challenges. The request came during the 5th Indian Ocean Conference in the United Arab Emirates.
The two-day 5th Indian Ocean Conference held in the UAE with the participation of 18 foreign ministers and more than 200 foreign delegates ended today. President Gotabaya Rajapaksa, who chaired the organizing committee of the conference, delivered his address last night.
Developing countries in particular have been very badly impacted. Countries that had taken on significant external debt to fund their development program are particularly badly affected, with very little reserves available to meet debt repayment obligations. The loss of revenue from tourism, the loss of foreign exchange remittances from expatriate workers, and the loss of export earnings have been especially devastating. Sadly, in contrast to the leadership provided by the WHO for the global pandemic response, no world institution has stepped forward to help countries navigate their economic recovery. It would therefore be greatly appreciated if more action could be taken by wealthy nations as well as multilateral organizations to restructure or grant moratoria for the debt repayments of poorer countries struggling in the wake of the pandemic.
President Gotabaya Rajapaksa has met with Dubai's Deputy Prime Minister and Minister of Finance, Sheikh Maktoum bin Mohammed bin Rashid Al Maktoum. This was at the Expo 2020 premises. Former Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe, who addressed the Indian Ocean Conference, said the power rivalries are causing instability in the Indian Ocean.
The simmering power rivalries between the US and China in the IOR. This picture becomes even more complicated by the addition of AUKUS military alliance, which also covers the Indian Ocean. These developments in an increasingly multipolar world order will bring about regional instability in the Indian Ocean. The entanglement of great power rivalry in the Indian Ocean risks removing the focus on the public health shortfalls, digital inequalities, education disparities, unemployment, and social fragmentation in some of our countries. The growing presence of advanced economies of Europe as outside players in the region could result in a throwback to the 17th and 18th century Indian Ocean scenario, with more powerful outside powers dominating the weakened Indian Ocean states. This is a wake-up call for our region. Therefore, we must act without delay. The starting point is the need for a summit of all Indian Ocean leaders sooner than later.
President Gotabaya Rajapaksa has refused to accept the resignations of the chairman and board members of the Board of Investment. The officials had tendered their resignations last week.
President's Secretary P.B. Jayasundara had written a letter individually to the chairman and the respective board members of the Board of Investment. He had said that the president wishes for them to continue their services as he has the highest confidence in them, as they contribute effectively to promote foreign investments to the best interests of the country and help the post-COVID economic transformation.
If the misrepresentation of facts by the COB and the targeted attacks by the BOI trade unions continue, it could damage the integrity of the BOI, and the board of directors and I decided that the need of the country would be best served by a new hierarchy that would continue to showcase Sri Lanka's talent and attractiveness to the world. During 2020, $1.4 billion worth of capital formation took place in Sri Lanka, of which $700 million was FDI. In 2021, $760 million was invested in the first 6 months, of which $400 million worth was FDI. In 2020, despite the COVID situation and in a backdrop where the global FDI pool has reduced by 40%, we managed to approve 128 projects to the value of $2.2 billion, of which the FDI component is $1.6 billion. In terms of exports, year to date, the exports value for BOI companies has reached the pre-pandemic levels observed in 2019. We have delivered all these results despite ongoing internal strife and in a post-pandemic FDI slowdown where the FDI pool has decreased by 40%. It is based on this performance, HE has the utmost confidence in myself as chairman of the board of directors and DG and the board on our capabilities and our contribution. And it was because of this he has refused to accept our resignations.
Opposition leader Sajid Premadasa says the cabinet recommendations on restructuring the tourism industry's debt after consulting the central bank's monetary board should be implemented.
Opposition leader Sajid Premadasa has said that Sri Lanka's tourism industry has been affected by the 2019 April 21st attacks and the pandemic. In a statement, he noted that tourism is a key component of the country's economy and a major source of foreign currency revenue. But the opposition leader observed that the job opportunities in sectors that depend on the tourism industry have been severely affected at present. He called on the government to prioritize the tourism industry, considering its importance to the economy. The opposition leader also pointed out that the opposition is concerned that some budget proposals will have a negative impact on the sector. He said the opposition believes that the 2.5% social security tax, in addition to the 1% tourism development levy, would have negative impacts. Sajid Premadasa pointed out that banks should restructure the loans obtained by the tourism sector while delaying repayment by 10 years with a grace period of 2 years while waiving the interest on long-term loans. The opposition leader said the Samaghi Janabala Vegas Intellectual Forum believes it is not the right time to amend the Tourism Act No. 38 of 2005. He said that while the current act needs certain changes, it is important to ensure the participation of the private sector when making decisions. The opposition leader said it is shocking to learn that the proposed new Tourism Act would hand over control to government agencies by maintaining the private sector as mere observers.
China's Qingdao Saving Biotech Company has sought a compensation of $8 million over its organic fertilizer deal with Sri Lanka. The compensation has been sought from Colombo Commercial Fertilizer Limited through an arbitration center in Singapore.
China's Qingdao Saving Biotech Company has requested for a three-member tribunal to be appointed to hear its complaint on the organic fertilizer deal with Sri Lanka. It has proposed a three-member tribunal with one representative from each side. The Qingdao Saving Biotech Company argues that Sri Lanka has violated the contract for the organic fertilizer purchase. The compensation sought by the company covers several costs, including production, freight, and demurrages. The Chinese company is also seeking an order for Sri Lanka to pay all arbitration costs, including its legal fees and other expenses. The $8 million sought by the company also includes interest rates. Agriculture Minister Mahinda Ananda Aludgamage says China's Qingdao Saving Biotech Company has gone to Singapore for arbitration because of a mistake in the agreement. The minister said although he has asked the Agriculture Secretary to insert a clause to conduct arbitration in Sri Lanka, that had not taken place. Qingdao Zivin Biotech Company has signed two agreements with Ceylon Fertilizer Company Limited and the Colombo Commercial Fertilizers Limited to sell its organic fertilizer product, but it has chosen Colombo Commercial Fertilizers Limited to appear on behalf of Sri Lanka as a respondent at the arbitration hearings. The Hippo Spirit ship carrying Chinese organic fertilizer is now heading to Singapore for arbitration. Agriculture Minister Mahinda Nandaludgamage said a special meeting will take place tomorrow. This would be to discuss the possibility of conducting the arbitration hearing in Sri Lanka, as there might not be a possibility of going to Singapore under the current circumstances. Minister Mahinda Nandaludgamage said his ministry has reached an agreement with the Attorney General. This was to increase the payments made to the Chinese company from $5 to $8 million and to pay 75% of the amount mentioned in the letter of credit issued by the People's Bank after the ship leaves Sri Lanka. Former Janata Vimukti Peramuna MP Sunil Handunneti expressed the following views on the arbitration hearing.
Now we don't have to pay only for the losses faced by the ship. They're going to Singapore for arbitration. We will have to pay arbitration fees and legal fees as well. The situation is such that we will have to unload the garbage in our country and then pay demurrages, legal fees and arbitration costs. Ultimately, the country will be cursed as the farmers won't have fertilizer. This is the truth.
The poor at Nati, Ratata Maha, Hinapatia Patkanatia Tamai Atiradi, Meka Tamai Atatati.
Sri Lanka had to pay millions of rupees in compensation for violating the oil hedging deal in 2009. Minister of Agriculture Mahinda Nandaludgamage said that a decision will be reached tomorrow on whether liquid nano-nitrogen fertilizer will be imported again to Sri Lanka. The Ministry of Agriculture said that the conduct of the local agent who brought down Indian liquid nano-nitrogen fertilizer to Sri Lanka has been subject to controversy. The ministry added that the conduct of the local agent outside the agreement resulted in the delay in importing liquid nano-nitrogen fertilizer from India. However, the Agriculture Ministry has informed the Fertilizer Secretariat to intervene in the matter and to produce a complete report regarding the matter. The Ministry of Agriculture noted that a final decision will be taken on the situation at hand at the end of the coming week. Shedding more light on the matter, the Ministry of Agriculture said that the problematic situation at present had arisen because necessary payments were not made to open letters of credit to import the fertilizer from India.
Government decides to import liquid nano-urea fertilizer from the Indian Farmers Fertilizer Cooperative Company in Gujarat. Two special cargo flights of the Indian Air Force reach Sri Lanka with 44,773 kilograms of liquid nano-nitrogen fertilizer. Sri Lanka Standards Institute says it has not set standards on nano-nitrogen liquid fertilizer. Indian nano-nitrogen liquid fertilizer distributed among farmers. Revelation on irregularities when importing nano-nitrogen liquid fertilizer. Agriculture Minister Mahinda Nandaludgamage admits that Indian Farmers Fertilizer Cooperative had sold its product to Sri Lanka with a big profit margin. Janata Vimukti Peramuna makes revelations in Parliament on fraud that occurred when importing nano-nitrogen fertilizer. Farmers raise complaints about Indian nano-nitrogen fertilizer.
They said they imported this from India. The crops died eventually.
While issues surrounding Indian and Chinese fertilizer are ongoing, farmers in rural Sri Lanka continue to bear the brunt of the fertilizer shortage. It has been nearly a month after a meeting was held on releasing water to fields in Galinbindanuweva. But the water that was released from the Dibulweva is now being wasted.
More than 1.8 million kilograms of paddy is harvested from these fields. We have lost this harvest. The government wants to make the paddy fields run barren. That is because they are planning to import rice.
The Low Country Tea Cultivators Association engaged in a demonstration in Moravaka this afternoon demanding fertilizer for tea cultivation.
If this situation continues, the tea industry will face a plight similar to the rubber industry. An Indian mafia is behind this. The government permitted us to mix 30% of our fuel. Sri Lankan authorities are stupid.
The government is intentionally avoiding the problem because they are afraid of India.
The Samagya Janabala Wege expressed its views on the crisis faced by the agriculture sector in the country and the worsening debt situation in the country. At a time when the country is battered on all fronts, it seems that we will have to face more challenges in the future. The government has destroyed the agriculture sector of the country with their cheap theatrics. They have shattered food security in the country as well. They resorted to this move to save dollars, but now they are trying to make payments in a large sum of dollars. The government will have to pay a large sum of dollars when we have to deal with an arbitration case like this. What should we do? We have to go to the entities where we have obtained the debt and we have to restructure the debt that we obtained. But when we go there, they will ask us whether democracy is upheld in Sri Lanka, whether we honor media freedom and human rights, and whether we protect the rule of law. The reason why this government cannot go to approach these entities is that this government has not done these things and that those entities won't believe even if they say they have done them. You have to establish democracy and approach the European Union, the Asian Development Bank and the World Bank and obtain loans for lesser interests and provide relief packages to the people of Sri Lanka.
The debt toll from the Kenya ferry tragedy has risen to 8.
A 41-year-old woman had died while receiving treatment in hospital.
I was employed in Qatar for 2 years. I received a phone call. When I returned, I learned that I had lost my son. There is a hospital in our area, but it doesn't have emergency treatment. Therefore, my wife was transferred to the Kilinochi Hospital. She was in a coma for 12 days. We are requesting the government to build the bridge immediately without considering this as just another incident.
News First learned that the construction of the bridge connecting Kenya and Kurinjankani has begun. 5 children had lost their lives as a ferry capsized in the Kenya Lagoon on the 23rd.
Up next is a look at Crime Watch.
Crime Watch.
A person known as Kisalwatte Fawaz was found murdered along Pir Saibu Street in Kisalwatte. What was the motive for the murder? Police said a group that arrived in a vehicle had tied the man and stabbed him with a sharp weapon. The incident was captured on security cameras.
The final rites of former Minister Sirisena Kure were held at the Boralla Cemetery today.
Former Minister and United National Party General Secretary Sirisena Kure had passed away on the 30th of November. Born on the 25th of April 1931, Sirisena Kure was 90 years old at the time of his demise. People paid their final tributes to the late Sirisena Kure at the respect Jayaratna Funeral Parlour. The final rites were carried out today.
Moving on to news overseas, at least 13 people have died and dozens more are injured after a volcano erupted on Indonesia's Java Island yesterday.
A volcano had erupted on Indonesia's Java Island yesterday, leaving 13 people dead and at least 57 injured. A spokesperson for Indonesia's Disaster Mitigation Agency said the injured were being treated at various hospitals and medical facilities. Pictures show villagers buried in volcanic ash up to rooftops. Locals have described thick smoke blocking the sun, leaving them in pitch darkness. According to officials, 902 people have been evacuated from the area so far. However, evacuation efforts have been hampered by choking smoke, a power blackout, and rainstorms during the eruption, which turned the debris into mud.
And in sports news, the fourth season of the Ceylon Fighting Championship was held last night in Colombo. The event was held for the fourth consecutive time.
Float like a butterfly and sting like a bee. The Ceylon Fighting Championship at the moment in Sri Lanka is the only platform for an up-and-coming MMA fighter to showcase their talents.
For the world of mixed martial arts here in our small but magnificent island of Sri Lanka.
The event was organized by Ceylon Fighting Championship. This year, 16 fighters from Kurunagala, Kandy and Colombo took part in the event. The eight fights that took place at the event were judged by Dushmantan Niranjan, Supun Dayaratna, Dilip Ranjan Dharmashree and Roshan Amarasingha. Kumud Patirana was the referee in charge.
For four consecutive years, we have been doing this event, and this is an event to sort of empower the youth and fighters of Sri Lanka. We'll be doing a season five also. You can come, support us, support the local talent and the fighters in Sri Lanka.
Mixed martial arts කියන්නේ හැම martial art එකක්ම එකතුවක්. So මේකට boxing කරන අය එන්න පුළුවන්, wrestling කරන අය එන්න පුළුවන්, wushu, karate, taekwondo, judo, brazilian jiu-jitsu මේ හැම දෙයක්ම තියෙන අයට එන්න පුළුවන් හදපු platform එකක් තමයි mixed martial arts කියන්නේ. So මේකේ ලංකාවේ අපි කරන්නේ මේ platform එකට අපේ ලංකාවේ ඉන්න young talents ඉක්මනට අපි හොයලා ගන්නවා. මොකද ලෝකෙ ඉස්සරහට ගිහිල්ලා තියෙන්නේ. ඉතින් අපි තමයි තාම පිටිපස්සෙන් ඉන්නේ. ඉස්සරහට අපේ එනවා amateur league එකේ ඇවිල්ලා ඕන කෙනෙක්ට participate කරන්න පුළුවන්. ඒගොල්ලෝගේ martial arts අපි කියමු boxing කරපු කෙනෙක්ට participate කරන්න පුළුවන්.
And with that, we wrap up tonight's edition of Primetime News. Thank you very much for joining us. For the News First team, I'm Arundhati Mudanayake, together with our interpreter this evening, Brian DeCruz. Good night.
You can now watch News First bulletins live on YouTube. That's not all. The developments of news stories can be found on our YouTube channel as well. All you need to do is click on the subscribe button down below. Stay tuned to News First.
News First, your life.